Good evening, everybody. So I'm grateful to be invited to speak for your Women's History program. I will admit that there's a certain irony in my being here today since I am a confirmed Luddite and do not have a computer at my desk, nor frankly ever use one. Might as well tell the truth, right? So I appreciate the good work that the civic tech community does here in Chicago and Cook County. I'm grateful to you. You just heard that we have an online annual report. It's ataglance.cookcountyil.gov. Tonight, though, I want to focus on the civic part of civic tech. Clearly, I'm better prepared and have more experience in that realm. I believe that public service is the duty of every citizen in a democracy. And that means canvassing your building or building applications such as mybuildingdoesn'trecycle.com or Chicago's Million Dollar Blocks. Public service can be a variety of things. And I think it's really important, however, that everybody in a democracy believe that they have an obligation to be part of the civic community. I think solutions to our most challenging problems aren't necessarily going to come from Washington or even other levels of government. They have to come from ordinary citizens. And that means that each of you has to define what public service means to you and how you can engage in the issues that matter most to you. I've often said that your first obligation as a citizen is to vote. That's necessary but not sufficient. Good citizens have to contribute their time and energy to the causes and individuals they believe in. That's the only way we're going to keep our democracy strong. And when citizens are engaged, good things happen. We all learn from each other, and people take an active role in improving their communities. For me, it started when I was 16 years old. I worked in my first political campaign for Katie McWatt, who was the first African-American to run for city council in St. Paul, Minnesota, where I grew up. We did all the stuff you do in campaigns. We knocked on doors. We talked to friends and neighbors. We stuffed envelopes, made phone calls. For those of you who've never worked in a campaign, I'll tell you that's a lot of fun, even though it doesn't sound like it. Katie McWatt didn't win the election, but when I came to Chicago, I decided that I would work in politics along with my studies. And I did that from the time I came here in 1965 until I was elected myself. I became an elected official when I was 43 years old in 1991. And in that interval, between the time I was 16 and 43, I worked for a lot of other good candidates. And that work has kind of shaped my view of things. Before I ran for alderman and won in 1991, I ran twice and lost. Now, one thing you could say about that is either I was persistent or too stupid to give up. But in 1991, on my third try, I won by 109 votes out of more than 11,000 cast. So I always tell, particularly young people when I speak to them, that it's really important that you vote. Your vote makes a difference. You know, if 100 people had decided to stay home that day who were my supporters, I wouldn't have won the election. And second, you know, life is not without challenges. And it's particularly important, I think, for young people to understand this, but for all of us to be reminded. I spent 10 years of my life trying to be elected to office, and I was successful, as I said, on my third try, partly because, as I said, I was too stupid to give up. When you're a kid, you're kind of, you know, contrarian, obstinate, and when you're an adult, you're persistent, and I'll take the persistence label. When I decided to run after 19 years in the city council to run for county board president, I knew I was a long shot. I was the only one of the candidates in the Democratic primary who hadn't run countywide. But I was confident that I cared more than the other candidates about the issues and that I was going to put in the time and energy and hard work that it took to try to implement my vision for Cook County. But let me tell you, running for countywide office is very difficult and much different from running for alderman, where you have a pretty small defined space within the city that's kind of your turf. Cook County has 5.2 million people, and it's very large geographically. I I tell the joke that there was a Sunday afternoon when we were down in Rich Township, which is sort of south central Cook County, and we had to go to Palatine for, we were an event there, and then we had to go to Palatine for a debate. And it took us an hour and a half on a Sunday afternoon to drive that far. So the geography and the density of the population make it a very challenging county both to run in and to govern. As a countywide candidate, one of the differences that I found from being alderman, of course, was the magnitude of money that you had to raise. You can get by in an aldermanic race, even in a tough one, with about $250,000 to $300,000. But we had to raise several million dollars to run countywide, and that was surely a challenge. And it's one of the principal challenges that women face in public life. I'm a teacher by profession. I spent 10 years teaching high school history. And I used to joke that if I'd known in my 20s that in my 30s and 40s I was going to run for office, I would have been an investment banker rather than a teacher. So I'd have some money myself and have rich friends that I could call upon. But in my generation, and shout out to the University of Chicago people, where I was 50 years ago. For my generation, there were really pretty narrow choices for professional women. You could be a nurse, or you could be a librarian, or you could be, as I was, a teacher. None of those professions, although they're important, and I'm a firm believer in the good work that nurses and teachers and librarians do, none of those professions will make very much money. If you have an inner circle of millionaire friends, who can fund your campaign with a few phone calls, you start out ahead of all the rest of us. If you don't have that kind of personal network, you've got to count on a lot of smaller donations. And no matter how much you believe in your own skills and qualifications, it's still hard to pick up the phone and ask strangers for money. Now, for your generation, there are a lot more professional opportunities for women, though clearly gender bias still exists. Another challenge remains, and that is how we raise our young men and young women. We allow or encourage our young men to be risk takers. We're not so likely to encourage our girls to be risk takers. We're more likely to encourage them to be cautious and to be nurturing. But if you're going to be successful in political life and public life, you have to be willing to take risks. Another reason I always encourage young people, especially young women, to be involved in politics is I think being in a campaign is a wonderful experience. It gives you a chance to learn new skills, to meet new people, and to better understand the issues of the day. In most election cycles, there's at least one candidate you can support wholeheartedly, and there are all kinds of responsibilities within a campaign, and having some experience in a campaign and knowledge of campaign roles is really invaluable. At the same time, I hope there's some people in this room who are willing to run for office. If our democracy is going to be strong, ordinary people have to step up and run. We can't leave elective office to millionaires and billionaires. But my 2 years on the campaign trail wasn't simply about raising money. As I said, we traveled from one corner of the county to the other, trying to talk to as many people as we could, as many organizations as we could, hearing about their concerns. Because I've always believed that it's not enough to make the right decisions. You have to explain them to the widest audience possible and try to bring everybody along. Whether it's going to a meeting or holding a Twitter town hall, it's the responsibility of our government always and everywhere to be transparent, accountable, and engaged. As both alderman and county board president, I've found it's much easier to weather difficult decisions if your constituents understand the issues, feel engaged, and feel they've been heard. At the same time, I think one of the toughest jobs, one of the toughest parts of the job of being an elected official these days for women is the role of the media. The media landscape has changed significantly since I was first elected in 1991. I was an alderman and I was able to work largely under the radar. This is partly because we have a tremendous number of elected officials in Chicago, but it's also because I was relatively far down the food chain as a lowly alderman. But also reflected the state of the media. It's not just the emergence of social media, but the tone of the media coverage has changed. In many ways, it's more aggressive and voracious, and I would argue vicious. It's hard to ignore the distinct gender slant in coverage. I used to say, you know, Michelle Obama was First Lady of the United States, and people were always talking about her hairstyle and her clothes. Now, she is a graduate of the Harvard Law School, and the fact that people paid so much attention to her hair, the way she wore her hair and her clothes, I think reflects very badly on all of us. Women are repeatedly asked how they balance their professional and personal lives. Not so subtle undertone is that you can't do both. That is, do well in your personal life and your professional life. And men never face this kind of questioning. They never have to justify or defend the balance of the personal and professional. Men also never have to deal with questions about how they wear their hair or their wardrobe. In my Cook County Board President campaign, the first time, there were several mentions of my sensible shoes. So here they are, flats, loafers. So whoever hears about the kind of shoes guys wear, you have to stay focused, you have to stay on message. In my campaign, we introduced a bumper sticker that said, sensible shoes, sensible leadership. Yeah, I've held office for 25 years now, and there are always challenges, but obviously it's an attractive job for me or I wouldn't be here. I loved being alderman. It's a great opportunity to serve your constituents. You're the equivalent of a small town mayor. You have 50 to 60,000 constituents, and they hold you responsible for the quality of their public schools and the safety of their streets, and whether or not they can buy groceries in their neighborhood, as well as, you know, whether you fix the potholes and make sure that the streetlights, when they go out, are turned back on. But I look forward to the opportunity of being county board president and the challenges there, particularly around the provision of public health care and the administration of our criminal justice system, and I've worked hard over the last 6 years to try to restore residents' faith and trust in Cook County government. But I did none of this on my own. I often joke with my staff that they do the work and I go out and take the credit. Would all of my Cook County staff please stand up? I'm particularly grateful tonight to Simona Rollinson and all the tech people who are here, who hopefully will help me answer any questions related to technology, since I'm clearly not qualified to answer them. Nothing can be accomplished without collaboration and cooperation in government. And it's never too early to build your own personal networks of friends and colleagues, associates and mentors, people who will help you, support you, challenge you, and help shape your thinking. There are people that I've known for decades that do that for me, and I encourage you to develop your own networks as well. I'm very grateful for the opportunity to say a few words tonight, and I would be happy to take your questions. Thank you very much.
Confusing. Okay. We're going to do questions. I know there are many, many things you could ask. Let's try to keep it on topic and also questions, not comments, please. So we'll take a few. So hands up if anybody has anything to ask. Yeah, back there. Oh, sorry, hold on. I'll run to the mic. Run with the mic.
Hello. Well, first of all, thank you for being here. It is wonderful to have someone in the dirt, if you will, of government being here to talk to us. So my question for you is, how do you see the relationship between the city and the tech community progressing over the course of this new presidential administration on a local level?
Well, I count on my good and competent staff to relate to the tech community. It's not something, frankly, that I do personally much myself. And I don't think that's going to change with the leadership in Washington. They're going to continue to go on and do their good work and interact and engage with all of you outside of what's happening in Washington. And actually, I think for government at all levels, I think this the next 4 years is sort of put your head down and do the best you can, despite the chaos and confusion around you. So, emanating from Washington, yeah.
I'd like to know a little bit more about how the county's dealing with the state budget crisis.
So the question was, how's the county dealing with the state budget crisis? So I think the first thing that you need to understand is that it's not just social service agencies that have been devastated by the failure of the state to have a budget. We know of many social service agencies that have either disappeared or dramatically reduced their services as a result of the fact that they no longer have contracts for the state. They were delegate agencies providing services out in the community. And because there's no budget, they no longer have the resources to do that. But every local unit of government in the state is impacted as well. We provide services for the state, and historically the state has reimbursed us for those services. Much of that is done in our healthcare system, but it's across the board in criminal justice and environment and all kinds of other places. In December and January, I went to visit the governor and the speaker and the president of the Senate and told them that their failure to have a budget was having a dramatic impact on Cook County. I brought them a spreadsheet from the last year. So month by month, I could show them what the state owed Cook County. And it was as much as $187 million, and as little as $57 million. Now, we happen to have a modest cash reserve, and we're able to manage the fact that the state owes us this millions and millions of dollars. But for small cities or other units of government that don't have those cash reserves, this is a nightmare. They have to borrow money to make payroll or to meet their obligations. The state may pay you. Sometimes they're paying us 6 or 7 or 8 months after we've delivered the service. Or in the case of last year, they decided that they weren't going to continue to fund programs that they had funded forever under agreements with us. And so we found ourselves at the end of the year without revenues that we'd anticipated at all. They were never going to show up. So this is a disaster. And my expectation on the basis of our lobbyists in Springfield is that there will not be a budget in this four-year cycle. They don't anticipate that either this year or next year there'll be a budget. This will get worked out in the 2018 elections. And that's a nightmare for the people of Illinois. But we're apparently at a point where many in the state legislature appeared to burn the house down rather than compromise. And so I'm a Democrat, full disclosure. And I always say, as an elected official in democracy, your first obligation is to pass a budget, okay? Your first obligation to pass a budget. It's a reflection of your priorities, and it's the basic framework for moving ahead in a fiscal year. And for 2 years, we haven't had one. And I think that's just damning. I can't see it any other way. And for the governor of the state to say that I will only work with you on the budget if you do X, Y, and Z that has nothing to do with the budget, you know, term limits or restrictions on public unions or changes in the way we deal with, you know, medical malpractice or whatever it is that he has on the table. What is it? Property tax freezes. But that's particularly cynical, since the state doesn't get any money from property taxes. It's only local units of government. So if you say there's going to be a property tax freeze in the state, you're hurting everybody but yourself. For the governor to say that, it seems to me, is particularly irresponsible. When I came into office, I had an ideological agenda. I wanted to try to support our public health system more vigorously. I wanted to change how we dealt with eligibility for affordable housing programs. I mean, there were all kinds of things I wanted to do that were outside the budget process. But I didn't say to the Board of Commissioners, I will only work with you on the budget if you do all these other things that I want done. We passed the budgets year after year. Year after year after year. We've never failed to pass a budget. But we worked on these other things. Sometimes I was successful, sometimes I wasn't. But I didn't say I only work with you on the budget if you work on this ideological agenda that I have, because I think that's just irresponsible. But I, as I said, I think we're at a place in the state of Illinois where the governor and the speaker are not prepared to deal with each other. And I quite clearly lay most of the blame on the governor, because he has this idea that he can tie these ideological issues to getting a budget deal, and also because as soon as he got in office, he tried to demonize the person that he really needed to work with, which was, Michael Madigan, the Speaker of the House, and an unprecedented way. I mean, usually in a democracy, we beat the stuffing out of each other in elections, and then we try to figure out how to work with each other, right? But what happened after he won in 2014 is in 2015, if you remember the summer of 2015, he spent more than $1 million in campaigns across the state of Illinois demonizing Michael Madigan and holding him responsible for all the ills of the state. Well, now it's, you know, Michael Madigan is a particularly proud person, but you don't have to be a particularly proud person to resent that kind of thing. And in the last election cycle, 2016, we saw the same thing, demonization of Michael Madigan across the state, and all of the Democrats who ran in the House were his puppets and that kind of thing. You know, if that's the way in which you treat somebody, it's sort of hard then to expect them to want to come to the table and work with you. It's kind of outside of the bounds of the rules of the game, even in rough and tumble democracies like Illinois. So.
I wanted to follow up on some of the revenue issues, and specifically about a county soda tax that was passed recently. I think obviously, like, there are a lot of worse ways to deal with revenue, and I think obviously it was opposed by a lot of, you know, Republicans and conservatives for the wrong reasons. But I do think it's fair to say that that is kind of a regressive tax that falls hardest on working people. I'm wondering whether you see the possibility for any ways to raise revenue with progressive taxes that, you know, some of the burden goes to the 1%.
So I think the most progressive taxes are graduated income taxes. But we do not have a we cannot have a graduated income tax in Cook County. That's, you know, not on the boards. And we don't have one in the state of Illinois. We have a flat tax, which I think is a terrible mistake. But the only way we can change that is to have an amendment to the Constitution. So at the local level, if you don't have income taxes, you're basically property taxes or other taxes. In my board of commissioners, there's 17 members. There's not one vote to raise the property tax, which I think is the least regressive of the alternatives other than a graduated income tax. But it doesn't matter what I think, because they don't have any votes for it. I could put forward, you know, we ought to raise property taxes and get zero votes. Now, what is that, you know, where does that go? So we've done things like raise the sales tax to meet our pension obligations and the soda tax. Now, in the 1960s, about 42% of adults in this country smoked. Smoking is very bad for you. And there were Surgeon General's reports about how bad it was. So one of the things that we did was start taxing cigarettes pretty highly, at not just the federal level, but state and local levels. There's been a long-term education campaign to try to reduce smoking and restrictions on where people smoke. And now 15% of adults smoke, 50 years later. I think that's a great outcome. So we use tax policy and sort of social policy restricting where you could smoke, with along with a public education campaign, to reduce smoking. I would argue that taxes on cigarettes are regressive. But I think it was a good thing, nonetheless. I would argue the same thing about soda taxes. You know, basically for every ounce of soda, it's a teaspoon of sugar. It's the American Heart Association and other health advocates joined with us in this effort to tax soda as we were looking for revenue. And let me be clear, we did this first and foremost because we needed revenue. But then what are you going to do to raise revenue that has the least negative impacts and some hopefully some positive impacts? And we chose the soda tax because we knew that drinking pop is bad for you. And by the way, even diet pop is bad for you. The carbonation, sucks calcium out of you. And so you it's bad for you even if you drink diet stuff. And it's particularly bad for you if you drink regular soda, because in addition to the carbonation, it's a teaspoon of sugar for every ounce. It's bad for your heart. It's bad for your teeth. It leads to obesity and diabetes. Anyway, it's terrible for you, okay? So our view is you got to tax, you got to get resources from someplace. We don't have progressive income taxes and we don't have property taxes on the table. So what else are we going to do? And that's what we picked. So I'm not going to argue with you about its regressivity, but I think there are other positive consequences of reducing the general population's, particularly the poorest people, consumption of things that are bad for them. Bad for all of us, but particularly bad for people who don't have the same access to good health care as those of us who are more comfortable.
You mentioned some of the sort of complementary initiatives or policies that led to the reduction of, I guess, the rate at which people smoke in America, based on the regressive, or, you know, I guess it's debatable, but regressive tax on cigarettes. What would you say are some of the initiatives that might be in the pipeline in Cook County to help educate people who are used to drinking soda and have become, you know, really reliant on it as a form of caffeine, of energy, to also have like other ways to access fresh fruits and vegetables and other foods that are also just as good?
So one of the things we started, the question is, what are we doing to get information about how bad soft drinks are for you, and to help those communities where soft drink consumption might be very high? I mean, one of the things we're doing is working with the Greater Chicago Food Depository, which you may be familiar with, which supplies food pantries around the county, to provide mobile vans that come to our clinics, our health and hospital clinics. So people who are coming to access health care can also have access to fresh fruits and vegetables through the mobile vans that visit those sites on a regular basis. So we're trying to work with Jesse is here. We've had a collaborative with them for the last 2 years. To figure out how we can work more closely with them to provide nutritious food in communities that are food deserts, or bring nutritious foods to people who are accessing healthcare or other services and who might be in need of more nutritious food resources. So that's kind of our response.
The question is how do we deal with the fact that the design of the dollar is fundamentally, like, the system doesn't work? And, but I mean, what I'm saying, and what I'm trying to apply is there's technology that can fix this problem, but then how do we get that technology in, right? We're trying to build software that, like, there's Bitcoin and blockchain stuff out there that will help fix this problem.
I think one of the hardest things in public life is to realize that there are a number of things that you can't do anything about. And this is surely one of them. So, I mean, what I always say is... No, just a second. What I always say is...
This is a Midwestern mindset. If you go to San Francisco...
All right. I'm not going to argue this point with you. What I will say is, as an elected official, you got to figure out what you can really focus on and have an impact on. Okay? And so what I focus on is public health, which is 46% of our budget. Criminal justice reform, which is 41% of our budget. Public safety, criminal justice is 41%. That's 87% of our budget. And then economic development, which is the three legs of the stool that I always talk about and which most of my time and energy goes to. Because those are things I can have a real impact on. And we've made some progress in each of those arenas. But I try not to spend time and energy on things that I can either have a minimal impact on or none at all.
This is David.
what's your best expectation as to what the Republicans will do about Obamacare, and what are your plans for dealing with that likely outcome?
So let me just say, when I was first elected in 2010, the Cook County taxpayers contributed $400 million to our health care system every year. $400 million. In this budget, 2017, it's $111 million. Now, some of that is efficiencies, but most of it is substitution of federal dollars for local dollars. We have a Medicaid expansion program, which is one of the many moving parts of the Affordable Care Act. That Medicaid expansion program is called County Care. Hopefully you've heard of it. And it provides health care to adults and couples that basically are working minimum wage jobs. And in the state of Illinois, it's the first time that such adults have been eligible for Medicaid, because previously it was a program that was limited to the disabled and to children through kid care, all kids. So if the Affordable Care Act, if Medicaid expansion goes away, we have a $300 million minimum hole to fill in our budget. I was bitterly amused that we heard from Republicans after the Trump inauguration, and they began to think about what they were going to do about the Affordable Care Act, that, you know, somebody said, this is actually pretty complicated. And I, you know, welcome to the club. I can't predict what's going to happen. 20 million Americans who didn't have health care coverage before now have it as a result of the Affordable Care Act. That's a pretty significant number of adults. And I think there are now 35 Republican governors, but 17 of those Republican governors opted to become part of the Medicaid expansion. You know, places like Florida and Ohio and Arkansas, unexpected places. And the governor of Ohio, Kasich, used the Medicaid expansion to deal with their heroin epidemic. Used it for behavioral health services. So there are advocates within the Republican Party, particularly in the state level, who it seems to me will not want to see big changes in the Affordable Care Act, plus the Democratic governors in the states that chose to become part of it. So it's hard to know exactly what's going to happen. I hope it just gets stalled for as long as possible. We've heard that the Republicans have three goals. One is repeal and replace the Affordable Care Act, then it's tax reform, and then it's infrastructure. Frankly, if I were them, I would have started with the infrastructure, because they would have gotten a lot of Democratic support for that. But if we're going to have to slog our way through repeal and replace and then tax reform, I'm not sure we'll ever get to infrastructure. I mean, given the fact that the present situation is really good for us, I hope that they don't get to changing it for a long time.
I think we have one last question. Yeah, in the back of the day. You, yeah.
Great. Wasn't so long ago the Department of Justice released a pretty damning report on the Chicago Police Department. You mentioned criminal justice as one of your focuses. Do you see similar issues at the county level? And what are your priorities in terms of criminal justice?
Okay. So first of all, you should understand that while we run a criminal justice system, we have a very small county police department. Very small. The county is made up of the city of Chicago, which is half of the population, and then there are 130 plus cities, towns, and villages in the suburbs. Okay? And many of them have their own police departments and whatever. So really, what our police, our sheriff's police patrol, is unincorporated Cook County, those parts of the county that are not cities, towns, or villages, and that's about 100,000 people out of 5.2 million people. So it's not a lot of our population, so we we have a relatively small police force. We are impacted by policing strategies in the city of Chicago because our jail, in our jail, about 80% of the people are there as a result of actions by the Chicago Police Department, even though Chicago is only half the population of the county. So it's half the population, but 80% of the people in the jail. And 86% of the people in the jail are black and brown, even though half the population of Cook County is African-American Latino, about 25% Latino, about 25% African-American. But again, the jail is 86% black and brown, overwhelmingly African-American, but 86% black and brown. And that, so that's a function of the way in which the Chicago Police Department polices African-American and Latino neighborhoods. And I've always said, you know, you can get arrested for stuff in black and brown neighborhoods that white people never get arrested for. Now, whether it's having a few joints in your pocket, or a Latina woman who is a judge and who I supported in her election came to see me one day and she said, you have to understand that they're arresting our kids, she meant black and brown kids, for stuff that they never arrest white people for. Not just the dope in their pockets, but things like shooting dice on the sidewalk. No, I'm sorry. That's petty antisocial behavior, but it's not something that anybody should go into the criminal justice system for. Not to mention, you know, what you've heard in the papers about who gets stopped driving, right? But I don't know, it's more than 3/4 of the people who are stopped by the police when they're driving are African Americans. They're not 3/4 of the drivers on the road. It's a function of the profound racism that's endemic in our country and in particular in law enforcement. So we've got some real challenges in Cook County in our criminal justice system. And they are disproportionately impacted by race and class. What I usually say is our jail is at the intersection of racism and poverty. Which doesn't exactly answer your question, but it surely lets you know what I think.